This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Come into God's presence with thanksgiving. And even though you may feel that you are not too many in number, let me encourage you, sing joyful songs of praise, telling the glad news of salvation from day to day. Will you please pray with me? God of all glory, on this first day you began creation, bringing light out of darkness. On this first day you began your new creation, raising Jesus the Messiah out of the darkness of death. On this first day, grant that we, the people whom you have created by water and the Spirit, may be joined with all of your works in praising you for your great glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first hymn is 476. We will stand and sing together. Please be seated. When I'm not preaching, and for the last year with COVID shutting churches, I haven't been preaching much, but I've listened to other Presbyterian services here and there, and I've noticed something that I never noticed all the time I was an active regular pastor about prayers of confession. And that is, usually, especially if they're printed in the bulletin, which is why yours is not today, they talk about, we have done that, we have not done that, we have done this, we have not done that. It's all very collective, very us together. And it is so easy to sit in a pew and say, well, that one's not true of me. Now, that one's not true of me. And before we're done, we're denying the whole thing. Accordingly, this morning, I'm going to pray on your behalf what I would call a very personal prayer of confession, very individual. And I encourage you, as you hear these words, you find out which ones of these do apply to you and absorb them and work with them and respond to them in your life as you see fit before God. Please pray with me. Merciful God, I confess that I have sinned against you in some of my thoughts, in some of my actions, and in some of my words, I have not been the person that you created me to be because I have turned most of my attention on myself instead of on you. Lord, I have done things I should not have done and failed to do things that I should have done. I have not loved my sisters and brothers as much as I have loved myself. And I have been more concerned with my happiness, my success, my prosperity than I have that of others. All too often, Lord, I have chosen to live in my cocoon and ignored the world around me, the world that is so needy and so hurting. I have chosen comfort whenever I could find it and self-satisfaction over obedience to your word. Lord, hear me and hear us as now in the silence of this moment we confess to you. Lord Jesus, in your mercy, forgive what I have been and what we collectively have been in our thoughts, words, and deeds. Help me and help us to amend what we have been, that we may become faithful servants, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends, the mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting. And so I may declare to you, and I do, that when you confess your sins before Almighty God, indeed you are forgiven, because God cleanses you of the past and prepares you for the present and for the future. We are forgiven. Praise be to God. Will you stand and let us sing together the Gloria Patri? Have a very interesting statement in your bulletin about passing of the peace. We're going to sing this song in a moment, and then, as I have been advised by one of you whose name shall remain nameless, do what you like to pass the peace one to another. Let us sing. Yes. Time's up. Will you please pray with me? O Lord our God, may we now take into our hearts your word, which you have laid out before us, so that our faith, knowledge, and wisdom may abound to your glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. Last Sunday, your preacher of the day began her sermon by laying out the importance in Scripture of telling stories, because we so often remember the story rather than the dry instruction, and she did it very well. This morning, we're going to have two more stories from Scripture, an Old Testament story and a New Testament story. And I want to begin by drawing your attention to the little book of Jonah, whose stories are usually remembered far better by our children than they are honored by us. Now, I know you all remember Jonah was the guy who was swallowed by the whale, spit out on the beach, but who lived to tell about it. But that is really not the important part of his story. The important part is what he did after the whale spit him out on the beach, and God then called to him a second time. Now, Jonah was an obscure Galilean prophet who one time, and only one time, had counseled King Jeroboam II in a successful conflict against the Syrians. Jonah had no other claim to fame. He was, as prophets go, pretty much of a nobody until the events that we read about in this morning's text. Now, I've always regarded Jonah's story here as being like a parable of Jesus, in that the truth of its history is not half so important as the truth of its teaching. This is a story that is far more important to be taken seriously than it is to be taken literally. This little book fills only a couple of pages, and this morning I'm going to read the second half of it to you. This is the part about Jonah's preaching mission. This is the part of the story that everybody usually forgets. This is the part where Jonah finally and unwillingly has gone to Nineveh, and he has been forced by God to become a missionary preacher. He never wanted to go to Nineveh, but now he is gone, and he is going to do what God has ordered him to do. He is going to preach repentance. Friends, hear the word of God and be redeemed by it, blessed by it, guided by it, and yes, challenged by it. Jonah chapter 3, beginning at the first verse. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind. That's a phrase we need to keep in mind, not just for today, but in our lives. God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said, "Is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, "It is better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the bush?" And he said, "Yes, angry enough to die." Then the Lord said, "You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their left hand from their right, and also many animals?" And this is the end of the story of Jonah. Now, our New Testament lesson is one of the parables of Jesus. It's one you've heard many times, and frankly, this is one of those parables that I think tends to be a pain in the neck for hardworking people like you and me. It's the parable about the workers in the vineyard. It's in Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. Hear this lesson from Jesus. "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You go also into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You go also into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last, then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour. You've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." Those of you who consider yourself more or less in the younger generation may not know what I'm talking about when I mention the phrase, the sawdust trail, but I suspect you older folks will. The sawdust trail refers to American Christian evangelism during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. An evangelist, a traveling preacher, coming to town, and he brings a big tent with him, sets it up in an open field or a vacant lot near town, sets out some folding chairs or benches, puts the word out to the local preachers that he's here, and perhaps in the local newspaper if there is one, brings along with him an old pump organ or maybe an old wind-up phonograph. Any of you remember those? I was raised in a house that had a wind-up phonograph about this high, and you cranked it all up, and you put the wooden needle on the 78 RPM disc, and you could hear real music. Well, he brings his phonograph or his pump organ. He spreads sawdust on the ground to keep the dust down. And this is where the phrase sawdust trail came from. And people came to get saved. Where to get saved again? There was a kind of legitimacy to this sort of evangelism that a local church usually could not pull off anywhere near so well. The local congregation could nurture the brothers and sisters in the faith, but it didn't seem to have too much of a hand in converting sinners to the faith in the first place. Now, once that had been the province of the old camp meetings, where people would gather from miles and miles around and spend days together singing and preaching and praying. Those days, though, were long gone. They'd been replaced by these independent traveling evangelists like Billy Sunday, Elmer Gantry, Amy Semple McPherson, and then, of course, the greatest one of all, Billy Graham. Now, I mean no disrespect when I tell you that often they blew into town, whomped up all kinds of religious fervor, preached a couple of humdinger sermons about our need for repentance, sometimes presided over the actual honest-to-goodness conversion of some of the local sinners. They passed the plate and were soon gone. Then the local congregation, you know, folks like you, would do what you could to pick up the pieces, to put these newfound Christians to work and nourish them within the more formal settings of the local church. Now, this morning, I want to take a bit of liberty with this text from Jonah, because I think of Jonah like a traveling evangelist, which in fact he really was, and I want you to see Jonah. There he is, setting up his big tent on a large vacant lot in downtown Nineveh, that teeming, steaming city. There he is, sprinkling sawdust underground all around to keep the dust down, arranging his wooden benches, posting handbills that say something like, "Big revival this Friday night. Come and hear Jonah, the great prophet of Jerusalem. Special music." I've never understood what special music really means. And my wife's a church musician. Well, anyway, he sets up his traveling pulpit, and he lays his big black Bible right on it. He tests the sound system, wants to make sure that those who are sitting in the back benches way over there, that they'll be able to hear him all right. He recruits some local folks to take up an offering and to pass out more handbills. He gets a big pitcher of ice and sets it right on the shelf in his traveling pulpit there, because it's going to be hot tonight. After all, he wonders, does it ever cool down in this vast human cesspool called Nineveh? And he sits down and he waits for people to arrive. And they do come. They come by the thousands, and they bring their children with them and their livestock. The place begins to take on the atmosphere of a state fair. They pack the tent. They spill over out into the streets all around. Their little children scurrying around here and there, as kids will do, trying to get up close so they can see this sunburned stranger from another land so far away. And then, surprise of all surprises, servants of the king come pushing their way into the center of the crowd, and they're carrying one of these fancy elevated chairs. You know, the kind that have the poles through the legs, and the king is up there sitting in that fancy chair. Here they are, they're carrying him in, and he has them put him down right smack in front of the pulpit. And Jonah begins to sweat just a bit more, because after all, he wasn't counting on this kind of a high-class audience. Now, you do remember, don't you, about those folks in Nineveh? They were an evil people. They were as mean as snakes, and Jonah knew it. He didn't want to be here. He wanted to be back home, dipping his toes in the Jordan River and counting his blessings. But God has made him come, and so he's come under duress, and all the while trying to figure out how on earth is he going to pull this off. So he's been thinking about it, and finally, he's figured it out. And now he's itching to preach judgment to these people because they're bad and God is going to get them big time. And so now he can hardly wait. He turns down the phonograph, which has been playing hymns really loudly across the rooftop, and he strides up to the pulpit as though he really knows what he's doing, pulls a big handkerchief out of his pocket, wipes his forehead, clears his throat, and he shouts into the microphone, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be overthrown. That's it. That's the whole message, the sum total of his sermon, an 8-word sermon. Y'all should be so lucky. But maybe, but just maybe, he was warming up to something considerably longer than that, but no one will ever know, because no sooner does he get these 8 words out of his mouth than the whole city repents right there on the spot, the entire city. I tell you, no preacher before or since has ever had results like that. Billy Graham, eat your heart out. Yes, they shout, we believe, we repent. And the king orders a fast, leads them all out to change into sackcloth and ashes. And there stands Jonah, all alone, under his big top, And he isn't even warmed up yet. Well, he had all kinds of things he was going to say about how bad those people were. And now they're all going out, and they're all out repenting all over the city. They're down on their knees. They're crying mightily to God for forgiveness. With one simple little phrase, the revival of Jonah has been a howling success. In this 8-word sermon, he has accomplished more than all of the other Old Testament prophets combined. Really, he has converted the biggest city in the evil enemy empire with one sentence. Now, I tell you, folks, this was a blowout. Truth of the matter is, most of us preachers would be ecstatic beyond words to have 1/10 such a success as this. Frankly, most of us are happy when we are privileged to take part in just one conversion every now and then. But Jonah has a whole city convert as a result of his little sermon. But is he happy? No, not at all. He is so angry that he could die, because the last thing in the world that he wanted was for the Ninevites to be spared. He wanted them to all go up in smoke like Sodom and Gomorrah. More than that, he wanted to be right. He wanted that city destroyed within 40 days, just like God had promised, because he had said so. Now, Jonah had put himself on the line for that message, and he expected God to fulfill his promise, and he barely gets these words out of his mouth that God's going to wipe the place off the map, and in effect, God taps him on the shoulder and says, excuse me, Jonah, but I've changed my mind about this. Now, as far as Jonah is concerned, you can't even depend on God anymore. And notice, everyone in this story, from God on down, repents. Everyone, that is, except Jonah. Jonah does not repent. In fact, he is furious with God, and he slinks off to the outskirts of the city, hoping that in spite of what God has just told him, in spite of that, maybe God will finally destroy it. You see, he doesn't want to accept the possibility that God's idea of justice and his idea of justice might not be exactly the same. He'd rather die. And when Jonah hunkers down in the little hut that he builds for himself, watching the city for some hopeful sign of destruction, you know, earthquake, fire falling from heaven, God appoints the castor oil bush to grow up over his head to shade him from the heat of the noonday sun. And Jonah likes that, but his small happiness here is short-lived, because the next day God appoints a worm and attacks the bush. Bush dies, and God blasts him with some sultry heat. Again, Jonah wants to die, as if this might ruin God's day or something. And God speaks to Jonah. Is it right for you to be concerned about this bush? Now, I tell you, this is a trick question. Because if Jonah says, no, it's not right for me to be so angry about the bush, then he is admitting that whatever happens to the bush is not his business, it's God's business. And in the same way, it is God's business what happens to the Ninevites, or even what happens to Jonah himself. And thus, that the job of running the world has already been filled, and Jonah need not apply for it himself. But on the other hand, if he says, yes, it is right for me to be angry about the bush, then he opens the door for God to compare the fate of the bush with the fate of a whole city full of people, so that Jonah can, just perhaps, get a glimmer of his own meanness, his own pettiness. Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And Jonah said, yes, Lord, angry enough to die. And God says to Jonah, and should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? And that's the end of this little book, that question. But if it were not the end of the story, I think that the next line would have been Jonah's reply to God, and that it would have gone something like this. No, God, you should not be concerned about Nineveh, no matter how many people and animals live there. For not only do they not know their right hand from their left, they do not know right from wrong. They do not know you from a hole in the ground. Wipe them out. That's what I say. That's what you told me you were going to do, and I told them so. Why should they have a second chance? Well, isn't Jonah a hard man to defend? After all, he'd just gotten his second chance, hadn't he, from God? And when he got it, he became obedient. He marched right into the lion's den of Nineveh to tell the folks there the bad news. Put it in contemporary terms. Jonah became like a modern-day rabbi from Tel Aviv under commandment of Yahweh, who drives across the deserts of Jordan and Syria and Iraq to tell that Islamic warrior a couple of years ago, that guy who was running this outfit called ISIS, that he is going straight to hell, eternal judgment and punishment, courtesy of God. That would be a rather dangerous thing for Jonah to do, don't you think? Jonah had risked his life for this message, and he wanted results. And his only consolation had been in thinking that it was going to, how delicious it was going to be, pronouncing judgment on all those sinners and seeing God wipe them out. Now, the fact is, Jonah had his reasons, and they were pretty good reasons. The Ninevites had devastated Jewish cities. They had killed Jewish people by the thousands, and they had deported those who had survived, taken them home to become maids and gardeners and slaves. And so, from Jonah's perspective, what a pleasure it was going to be to see God wreak havoc on those awful people. What sweet revenge. Now, if no one has ever done you an evil deed, if no one has ever cut you down to size, if no one has ever done you an injustice, if no one has ever made your life miserable, you may have just a little bit of trouble understanding the punchline of the story. Or for that matter, maybe hard for you to understand that little parable of Jesus about the laborers in the vineyard. Some of them worked hard all day. Some worked half the day. Some worked barely at all. Yet at the end of the day, they all got paid the same wage. And the folks who worked hard all day got angry that they didn't earn more than those who worked only a few minutes. Now you see, both of these stories poke a big hole in the ribs of people like us who want God's mercy for ourselves, but God's justice for everybody else. Now we rejoice, we truly do, usually, when undeserved blessings come our way. Some of us will even then cook up some reasons why we did deserve these blessings after all. Can't you just hear Jonah saying to himself, as the castor oil bush is giving him that lovely shade for such a brief period, "I deserve this. It must be because God really liked the firm tone I took with the Ninevites. How delightful, a small unexpected bonus for my obedience." But I tell you, friends, that even when we know that the blessings that were just delivered in a big package to our doorstep have been delivered to the wrong address, that we don't deserve them, there are not many of us who will send them back to God because we know that they are undeserved. Oh no, we'll carry them inside as fast as we can, unwrap them, and just maybe give God a quick word of thanks. But when we see the identical package of blessings coming in the identical delivery truck and being delivered to the folks next door, those folks whom we know are simply not half so deserving as we are. You know what I mean. Those folks who sit out there in that old stuffed sofa on their front porch, swilling beer in broad daylight. Folks who have what we are sure have, shady business dealings, who are no account, lazy bums. Those kinds of people. The kinds of people we would never associate with. Well, when good things happen to those kinds of people instead of to us, we tend to resent that, don't we? We tend to resent it. You see, in our well-managed world, undeserved blessings are supposed to come only to those who are, well, good enough, deserving, like us. We're such bookkeepers, and God obviously is not. When the Ninevites repent, when the day laborers at the end of the line get paid the same as the hard-working fellows at the head of the line, And the people whom we judge most harshly, because they're pretty bad people, when they receive the mercy of God, it becomes painfully clear to we who profess God that grace doesn't work the way we think it should. God doesn't seem to keep track of things the way that we do. Apparently, God does not spend as much effort as we do deciding who is worthy and who is not. And that's a challenge for us. God doesn't seem to give any one of us what we deserve, but what we need, and ever so much more. And we find it very hard to trust God's judgment in this. I have never known a single child, including me, who really appreciated the favors that our parents showed to our brothers and sisters. When I was a child, and my older brother David had to have his tonsils removed. He was about almost 4 years older than I was. And he came home from the hospital, and they went to the store and they bought a couple of gallons of ice cream, a ton of ice cream, to soothe his sore, puny little throat. And I didn't get any. I absolutely, positively knew how unfair that was. And not of sound mind, but drawn up to my full 6-year-old stature, I told my parents what I thought about that. Not smart. To no avail, I might add. But you see, there is in each child's head a clock and a calculator, and we keep book on every moment and every instant that our brother or our sister gets a better deal, a bigger piece of apple pie, or whatever. And you know what comes out next. It's not fair. No, of course it's not fair, it's grace. And I do believe that those of us who get offended by the divine distribution of it have simply forgotten who we are. We think that we are the righteous prophets sent to pronounce judgment on the scuzzy Ninevites by whatever name we apply to them. We think that we are the diligent, sober, hardworking, righteous workers who deserve more pay than those shiftless drifters who show up an hour before quitting time. That's how we see it. And we make the mistake of presuming that God is also a Protestant work ethic God who sees things in exactly the same way. What we cannot see, and what we cannot know, is that maybe, just maybe, from where God sits, we are, every one of us, a mess. Oh, I know, some of us clean up a little better than others. Some of us have figured out how to manage our fears by doing good works. But when you get right down to it, we are, all of us, Ninevites. We're all scuzzy ne'er-do-wells. Only I don't think God would put it that way, because these are human labels full of human judgments. And from where God sits, I expect that we all look like hurt, lost, sick children. All of us in deep need of mercy and of grace. Now, be very clear about what's going on here. We are always, always tempted to being caught up between two seductive and evil attitudes. On the one hand, we're tempted to be jealous of anyone who gets more than we do. You know, those folks who have more in terms of something that we want, they got more of it than we do. But on the other hand, we are tempted to arrogance toward anyone who has less than we do. They're not as smart. They didn't work as hard. They're not as good. They're not as deserving. And on go the so-called reasons why we are better than they are. Now, don't you tell me that you were never, ever tempted either to envy or to arrogance. Because if that is true, then indeed you are already a saint, and the angels are already singing your praises in heaven. So I ask you, is it right for us to be angry instead of joyful when someone else receives a blessing? If Nineveh is spared, who among us would be unwilling to shout, "Praise God, hallelujah"? If the current day president of Syria, who has been proceeding full scale to destroy the people of his own nation, including a lot of Presbyterians, if he were to confess his sins and ask God for forgiveness, Should God forgive him? Should we? After all, because we're Presbyterian. At least there were a lot of Presbyterians in Syria before he went on his attacks a few years ago. If either the Israelis or the Palestinians should repent of their warlike ways and decide to live in peace with each other for a change, should God forgive them without first punishing them? How about if we lost a loved one in that high school shooting a couple of years ago in South Florida? If that is that miserable young man, the shooter, is he forgivable by us, by parents and friends of those killed, by God? I ask you, aren't we supposed to be in the forgiving business? Aren't we supposed to be in the healing business, healing our society by the grace of God? Isn't that what Christians are supposed to be about? Does not the work of grace require of us not only that we be graceful people, but that we work in our society so that it will become more graceful as well, in the hope that would-be shooters will not shoot other people, and equally that they will not be enabled to shoot other people so readily? Instead of so many of us going about in our lives filled with anger and jealousy, may we not turn around the public life that surrounds us? Too many of us in our American Christian society have a serious attitude problem, even though we know we are children of grace. So, if those who show up for work at the end of the day open their envelopes and find a full day's pay in them, who is there among us who won't rejoice in their good fortune? Is there one among us who hasn't been forgiven by God many times? Who hasn't been forgiven by our husband, our wife, our parents, our children, our neighbors, our co-workers many times over? Do we truly begrudge the forgiveness that others receive? Who would do that? Who would do that? I'll tell you who. Only those of us who don't know who we are, that we are some of God's children, already blessed, already forgiven, already loved, already cherished. It'll be people who don't know that we are already recipients of God's wonderful grace. But those of us who do know, well, we'll be down on the square in Nineveh, whooping it up at God's party with all of the other folks, all the other sinners who have been forgiven. Those who may not know their right hand from their left, with all the many animals as well whom God has spared, living within the amazing grace of God because God has invited us to his party. And I hope that you believe in grace. And I hope that you give grace to each other every day, because you and I, we need to do that. Because we are, every one of us, a fallen people, we stand in the need of grace. We need grace from God, and God offers it. That's what the gospel of Jesus Christ is all about, God's grace. And we need grace from each other. Though the truth is, we're a tad more stingy than God is about giving grace to each other. But we are, every one of us, a people called by Jesus to lives of grace, grace among us, being graceful every day. One more thing. We're living in a time of great national challenge. It doesn't matter whether you're a Democrat or Republican or a know-nothing. There are many who are fearful, many who are angry, wanting revenge for this or that wrong that has been done to them. That's only natural. We're human, after all. But in the light of Jonah's experience, can you pray for your enemies that they might repent and receive the forgiveness of God? And could you rejoice if they did? What about those of you who do consider yourselves Democrats or Republicans? There's an awful lot of hateful warfare going on between peoples of various political stripes in our American society. What should we, who follow Jesus, be doing to bring about healing in our American, we used to call it American Christian society? You see, because we're followers of Jesus, we've got to come at things quite differently from those who are not. The world doesn't believe in grace or in repentance. We Christians do. This is part of our heritage. What do you think Jesus would say and do if he were to walk the streets of our land these days? What would he say about the mean thoughts that go through so many minds, yours and mine as well, every now and then when something doesn't happen the way that we want? Don't we have a lot of souls searching ourselves to do about all of this? We have people we're angry about, people who on our side have done wrong things, people who've been bad or stupid or evil. But we have a lot to clean up in our own lives too, don't we? Before we get too bold about criticizing others. Finally, let us never, ever mistake God's grace for God's approval of our sinfulness. Grace is given to us that we may clean up our lives in response to God's prior love. Because God is a God of mercy as well as a God of justice. God is a God of forgiveness as well as a God of punishment. God is a God of grace, and frankly, we don't understand that too well, do we? But it's about time we begin to understand it. Now, I hope you have some stuff to take home and digest over the noontime meal today, but if you're one of those for whom a Sunday sermon is past all knowledge and understanding by the time dinner is over, let me give you with just four words not to forget. Be grateful. Be graceful. And to God be the glory. Will you please pray with me? Almighty God of all creation, open our hearts to the possibilities of repentance, forgiveness, and grace. Remind us again that although you created us for good, we've chosen sin because we like it, because so often we think we get something out of it. Teach us that we were created to love one another, to look out for and care for one another, that we were created to be peacemakers and healers. Oh Lord, our God, teach us to love the good more than we love the evil, to love the light more than we love the darkness. Remind us again that we are children of grace, and help us day by day to live lives of grace, living with loving and trusting hearts, in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Pray with me. O Lord our God, as we come to you now, in the quiet comfort of this moment, and in this place where we know that we are safe and loved, we acknowledge that all is not safe or lovable outside our doors. Our world seems to be virtually on fire with anger, with hatred, with lack of respect for one another, with disease and famine, with warfare, with fires and floods and storms and buildings collapsing. Evil seems to be abounding with energy, and goodness seems so overwhelmed by it all. The world seems to be coming much more fearful as a place, and we ourselves seem to be becoming much more willing to suspect others than to trust others. Then too, Lord, there are all those people we worry about, people whom we know or know of, whose bodies are failing them, whose healing may be in doubt. Lord, maybe it has always been this way, but with modern communication, we're just so much more aware of all the evil and trouble that surrounds us. In the face of all of this, show us how to be resolute in our faith, fearless when doing what is right, loving when it would be so much easier to be hateful, kind when callousness is all the rage. Show us how to see the good in each other and how to draw the good out of each other. And let it start with us, Lord. Teach us again that there is also so much good in this world that is also laid out before us. Teach us to be living examples of the good, that others may be drawn to you by the example they see in us. May we model the Christian faith that we already know so well, so that the light that shines forth from this church and its people may shine out into the dark world and help to provide a pathway for those who are lost or who have gone astray in the darkness. Lord, use us in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Master and our Savior, who taught us when we pray to pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We live in strange times in terms of health and medicine. The church that I normally worship at, if I'm not preaching someplace like you, no longer passes the plate. And preachers, of course, worry about that, that if the plate is not passed, some folks won't leave anything. We do what we are called on to do. There is a plate out at the door for you to leave something in if God leads you to do that on your way out of the door. But in the meantime, we're going to have some offertory music to reflect upon the gifts that we have received and the gifts we need to give. Thank you. Will you stand and let us sing the doxology together, please? Pray with me. O Lord our God, everything that we have was yours in the first place, is yours now, and shall be yours forever and ever. We give you thanks for entrusting us with so many blessings, and we pray that you will continue to guide us in their use for your glory. Amen. Our closing hymn is 538. Lord, dismiss us with thy blessing. Friends, go out in the world in peace. Let hope keep you joyful. And the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit will rest and abide with you all this day and indeed forevermore. Amen. Thank you.